Here we go. Now we can start, OK? Can I take this opportunity, of course, to welcome the First Minister to discuss with the conveners the government's programme for government. And can I extend a very special welcome to Sitting and In School, who are here to listen to this session. I hope you'll find it interesting for your modern studies in the year to come. So let's just get underway. First question, Duncan McNeill from the Health and Sport Committee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Good afternoon, First Minister. One of the issues that appears in the Scottish Government's programme of work is to tackle inequality, and that's a shared interest with the Health and Sport Committee. And I think we had a debate this year, and we all agree, I think, that there's a complex issue. Many issues and circumstances affect that. But, of course, I think we'd also agree that income is a big issue. It can make a difference. In November 2011, the Health and Sport Committee recommended that in their report on elderly care, that social care staff should receive the living wage. And I know that the government and local authorities are working pretty hard in trying to achieve that. Could you give me an update on those talks, what progress has been made and when we're likely to have an outcome? One addendum to that, could you also tell us if there's similar talks taking place with NHS-funded pharmacists, dentists and GPs?
Okay, thank you for that, and thank you, Presiding Officer, for the opportunity to be here today. In terms of the first part of your question, Convener, I can't give you a specific date for a specific announcement, but I can say that the Health Secretary, with COSLA and with local authorities, is looking very hard, as you acknowledged yourself, about how we extend the principle and the practice of the living wage into the social care workforce. And obviously, there are two main aspects of the social care workforce, those working in care homes and those providing care in people's own homes. So I'm very happy to make sure that your committee, as well as the collective group of conveners, is kept up to date with that as it progresses. We are also seeking, through the work that Rosanna Cunningham, as the Fair Work Cabinet Secretary, leads, and through the Business Pledge and through the Fair Work Convention, we're looking at how we extend the living wage into other areas of the economy where it's not currently paid at the same levels as it is economy-wide. And you mentioned some specific sectors there. There are other sectors out with the health sector, for example, retail and tourism, where there's a particular need to extend the living wage. And I fairly recently convened a living wage summit to look at how we do that. I mean, on the positive side, we have a slightly higher percentage of people in Scotland paid the living wage than is the case across the UK as a whole, but we want to extend that even further. So we will look to discuss with specific sectors, including the ones that you mentioned, and those discussions in many respects will be ongoing about how we extend the living wage further.
I mentioned pharmacists, obviously, and dentists and GP practice because they're, directly funded by the NHS, and I welcome the initiative, with the Scottish Government and local authorities and the funding arrangements there that can give you an added influence. And I would hope that some work can be directed at the pharmacists, dentists and GPs practices, to make progress and get more of them on the living wage register.
Many of these workers that you talk about, of course, will already be paid the living wage. And, of course, any NHS staff on Agenda for Change, for example, will already be paid the living wage because we pay the living wage throughout the NHS. If there are any remaining groups of staff working for independent contractors, and I'm happy to provide some details specifically to your committee as to whether that is the case and what magnitude we might be looking at, we'll certainly be continuing to make efforts to rectify that.
I think it would help them focus as well in their responsibility. Mm-hmm. Quickly, because we are limited in time, the Health and Sport Committee produced a report, again, with a common interest with the Scottish Government on access to medicines in 2013. In early 2014, the government responded and announced that the patient voice would be put at the centre of the new drugs approval process. However, I heard recently and been contacted that since then all three breast cancer drugs put through the new system have been rejected, prompting breast cancer campaign charities to raise concerns over the impact of the new system on the patients in Scotland. And last night I was very surprised to hear from a patient seeking access to new drugs that she was still subject to an ITPR process, an independent personal treatment review process that you will know about, First Minister, from your previous experience, that she was still subject to that, and she had the support of her oncologist and failed to get this medicine. Now, I thought we had resolved some of these issues, and I think it might be worthy of review to about where we are on new medicines to ensure that the government's plan, the Health Committee's objective, has been met right across Scotland?
Well, I'm happy to consider, as will the Health Secretary be happy to consider, any individual cases and any evidence of where we could further improve the system. I'm loath to comment on the individual case you've
cited
because I don't
mention
have
the
details
case
of that. But
yep.
What I would say, if you want to pass that to me or to Shona, we'd be happy to look at that. If I can just very briefly make a couple of points. The Scottish Medicines Consortium, we've looked and you are very aware of this, given the work that your committee has done to improve and to streamline and to make the procedures the SMC use more transparent than they were previously. There will always be difficult decisions that the SMC requires to take, and there will always be decisions that individual patients and patient groups, for understandable reasons, disagree with. But then we have the IPTR process, the individual patient treatment process, which is an absolutely fundamental part of the overall arrangements in place, because they are there to make sure that where there are particular circumstances in an individual case where a drug that might not have been deemed to be generally meeting the criteria for approval, where it would benefit an individual, they can still be prescribed that drug. And of course, we've established the Rarer Drugs Fund in order that there is additional financial resources available to health boards in these circumstances. So I think, and as you alluded to earlier on in your question, I've got some considerable knowledge and experience as Health Secretary of how these systems operate, their deficiencies as well as their strengths. And I think the changes that have been made in recent times have considerably strengthened the systems we have in place. But if there are ways we can do that further, then I am certainly open to looking at that. The last point I would make, though, is a point I don't particularly like making in these discussions, but I think it's one we all have to recognise. We will always have, given what we are talking about here, very difficult cases where patients, either groups of patients or individual patients, are not able to access a drug that they believe, and they understandably believe, would be of benefit to them, because the nature of these discussions and the nature of the procedures that are in place is that is inevitable. What we want to do is minimise the cases in which that happens.
Thank you. I'm going to call Kenneth Gibson, Convener Finance, followed by Christina McKelvey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I mean, next week Parliament will debate the Finance Committee's report into Scotland's fiscal framework, the relationship between Scotland and the UK as we move forward. I'm just wondering where we are in terms of some of the key discussions in relation to that fiscal framework. In particular, I'm thinking about resource borrowing in order to deal with potential economic shocks. Baseline position in relation to the block grant adjustment, and also the no detriment principle, whereby powers devolved from the UK to Scotland will not disadvantage either Scotland or the UK.
Well, there is not yet any conclusion to the discussions that are ongoing between the Scottish Government and the UK Government. John Swinney had the most recent of these meetings last week, and I know he has committed to keeping your committee and Parliament as updated as possible as these discussions progress. And I think next week's parliamentary debate will be a good opportunity, not just for the Deputy First Minister to feed back in the detail of where these discussions have got to, but also for MSPs to feed in views or indeed ask further questions about the detail of some of this. There is a debate about, you know, the degree of transparency it's possible to have around intergovernmental discussions like this when they're ongoing, but we work on the basis that we want Parliament to be as involved as possible. You mentioned some of the substantive areas that are not yet concluded, so we don't yet have agreement on. The block grant adjustment mechanism is of critical importance, both in terms of the reductions to our block grant that will flow from the Scottish Parliament having enhanced revenue raising powers, but also the additions to the block grant that will flow from the Scottish Parliament taking on additional spending responsibilities, in particular around welfare issues. So getting those mechanisms right, not just in the first instance, but making sure that those mechanisms are right for the future, is going to be hugely important. We continue also to have discussions around the borrowing powers of the Parliament. You know, there has been a suggestion, and you know, it's been a suggestion that a prudential borrowing regime should replace our existing capital del. That certainly was never the understanding that the Scottish Government had when we were making the case for borrowing powers for the Parliament. And I, although I can't speak for the Smith Commission, I would doubt very much if that was the understanding the Smith Commission had. So these are issues that we require to resolve. I am optimistic and that we will resolve them. I remain absolutely determined that we resolve them, because I want to see, albeit we may get into some of this later on, albeit my views on the inadequacies of the current Scotland Bill powers are well known. Nevertheless, I want to see that process come to a conclusion in the timescale that was promised. But as I've said previously, and as I said in the Programme for Government statement, the fiscal framework that surrounds the Scotland Bill powers is so important that the Scottish Government would not feel able to recommend legislative consent for the Scotland Bill unless we had in place a fiscal framework that we also thought was fair to this Parliament and fair to Scotland. I very much hope that we get to that position.
Okay, thank you very much. Just a couple of points just to ask for further information. Do you know when deliberations will be concluded, given the fact that the Scotland Bill is obviously going through Westminster at the moment? And in terms of prudential borrowing, the Financial Committee across the board took the view that prudential borrowing would be permissible, we would hope, in addition to capital departmental expenditure limit and not as a replacement for it.
Well, the objective and the hope of both governments is to have the fiscal framework discussions concluded by the time the Scotland Bill is concluded, so that by the time this Parliament is taking the decision on whether or not to grant legislative consent, we have clarity around the details of the fiscal framework. But you know, we are not yet at a stage where I can give you a date when those discussions will conclude, because there are you know, significant issues of substance that still require to have agreement between the two governments. And your second point, what you've just narrated there as the understanding of the committee is entirely the understanding that the Scottish Government has always had, that borrowing is intended to be in addition to the capital del arrangements in order to enhance the ability of the Government and the Scottish Parliament to invest in infrastructure. That's our understanding. I think that would be any reasonable understanding of that, but we continue to seek to bring that to a satisfactory mutual understanding.
Thank you, First Minister.
Thank you, Christina McKelvey, Convener of the European External Relations Committee. And Christina will be followed by Hugh Henry.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Good afternoon, First Minister. The European and External Relations Committee are undertaking three discrete pieces of work right now. One immediately tomorrow on the refugee crisis and how we can support that. We'll hear from the UNHRC a high representative tomorrow on that. The other issue is obviously the impact on Scotland of an in-and-out referendum on Europe. And the third thing is the impact on Scotland, not just the Scottish Government, not just the rights of the Scottish people, but the actual function of this place on the repeal of the Human Rights Act. So, First Minister, I asked you if you could maybe give us some update on where you are with all of these things and maybe some of your thoughts on the actions that can be taken.
Okay, let me, as briefly as I can, take three rather big items in turn. Firstly, in terms of the refugee crisis, I met the Foreign Secretary last week and Hamza Youssef, the minister who's leading the work for the Scottish Government on the refugee crisis, also met the newly appointed UK Minister for Refugees on the same day. Now, obviously, the UK Government, in terms of deciding how many refugees come into the country, over what time period, and where those refugees come from, the UK Government is very much in the lead. what the Scottish Government has been doing is twofold. Firstly, seeking to persuade the UK Government, although we welcome the movement that has been made, persuade them to go further, not to necessarily see 20,000 over the lifetime of the Parliament as the absolute cap, also to look at perhaps front-loading the number of those so that we are, you know, responding in an appropriate way given the scale of the crisis that's been faced just now. We've also been seeking to persuade the UK Government not simply, although I don't underestimate the importance of this, not simply to focus on accepting refugees from the camps around Syria, but also to look at playing a part in relocation and resettlement of refugees who've already made the journey to other European countries. Now, it's fair to say the UK Government is not indicating that it's going to change its position on those things, but we'll continue to make, I hope, a persuasive case. In terms of what we understand to be the case, the 20,000 commitment from the UK Government is over the period of this UK Parliament. Now, it is not yet clear what the profile of that will be, although the best information we have is that for the remainder of this year, those numbers may continue to be relatively small, perhaps in the hundreds, although we don't know that for certain yet. Obviously, because the UK Government is working through an expanded version of the Syrian Vulnerable Persons Relocation Scheme, the process of accepting refugees through that scheme goes through the United Nations in terms of recommending who comes here. So that, you know, clearly adds to the time scale, but we are hopeful that that process will speed up. So that's the first aspect of the Scottish Government's work, to seek to work with and persuade the UK Government to expand what it's seeking to do. But secondly, to make sure that whatever the numbers are that come to the UK, Scotland is ready to take a proportionate share of those refugees in Scotland. And Hamza Yousaf has been chairing the refugee task force that I established to look at, to work with local authorities and other agencies to make sure that in terms of housing, provision, support services, health services, support for language, we have those practical arrangements in place, and we're confident that we are well placed to do that. We've got already a very good, I think, set of arrangements in place in Scotland for integrating refugees, which allows us to build on that. Secondly, on European Union, my position on the EU, I think, is well known to everybody. I think it is in Scotland's strong interest, and indeed I think it's in the UK's strong interest, to remain members of the European Union. I think there are many aspects of the European Union that are ripe for reform, but I think in all circumstances our interests are better served by being in the EU. Obviously, that was one of the other issues I was discussing with the Foreign Secretary, and, you know, he was able to update me as far as he could on the progress of negotiations. I think it's fair to say that the my impression is that the UK Government doesn't yet have an absolutely clear sense of in detail what it's asking for or what it's likely to get out of the current renegotiation. So we will continue to watch that with intense interest. The other point I was impressing on him was the need for Scottish ministers to be fully updated as the negotiations progress, and also to have the opportunity to influence those negotiations, given that the outcome of them may impact very centrally on our devolved responsibilities. And to be fair to the Foreign Secretary, there was a willingness to seek to do that. The JMC on Europe will have updates at its meetings, and there was a willingness for ministerial updates, so I will certainly take the Foreign Secretary up on that. And lastly, on the Human Rights Act, again, you know, I've made my position and the position of the Scottish Government clear. We think that repealing the Human Rights Act would be a backward step. Obviously, it's not yet clear whether what the government wants to do, UK government wants to do, is simply repeal the Human Rights Act or to withdraw from the European Convention on Human Rights. I think the latter of those would be, you know, catastrophically backward looking, but I think even just repealing the Human Rights Act would be a backward step. And ironically, would actually as far as I can see, not help with one of the stated objectives, which is to make the UK courts more supreme, because it would actually mean that people had to go to Strasbourg to exercise or assert their human rights. The last point I would make on this is my strong view, given the way human rights is embedded, hardwired into the infrastructure of this Parliament, is that repeal of the Human Rights Act would require a legislative consent motion. If one comes forward, it would be my strong advice to this Parliament that we shouldn't give legislative consent to the repeal of the Human Rights Act.
That's great, thank you.
Hugh Henry, convener of the Welfare Reform Committee, and Hugh will be followed by Bruce Crawford.
Okay, thank you, President Officer. First Minister, the Welfare Reform Committee has commissioned research from Sheffield Hallam University, which has demonstrated that the biggest factor in getting people off benefits is not cuts to benefits, but is actually economic growth, which can encourage people into employment. I don't know if the Scottish Government has had a chance to look at that research and what your comments on that would be, but more specifically, once we get the additional powers that will be granted over over benefits, will you give a commitment that the budget will be as it is just now before any UK government cuts? And will you also give a commitment that those who are currently on benefits, before there's any further changes by the UK government, that none of them will be losers in any new benefit system?
Well, firstly, in terms of the Sheffield Hallam research, the government pays very close attention to all of the very good research that's been done for the Welfare Reform Committee from Sheffield Hallam, and we'll look closely at this. In principle and in summary, I very much agree with that conclusion, that you know, we will help people out of poverty and off benefits by helping them into jobs, and we find it easier to help people into jobs when we've got a growing, vibrant economy creating jobs, and that's very much the focus of the Scottish Government's approach. And of course, we've got, you know, employment levels now in Scotland that are higher than anywhere else in the UK, including youth employment levels that are, I think, at a 10-year high, female employment levels that are at a record high as well. So that's all positive. In terms of the second part of your question, and you know, these are issues that actually relate back very strongly to the question and the issue that Kenny Gibson raised with me around the fiscal framework. I want to have more powers over welfare, and I don't think the powers that are in the Scotland Bill go far enough here, but nevertheless they give us more powers than we have just now. I want to have them in part so that we can have a better social security system, and that we can protect people from the cuts, often indiscriminate cuts, that are being made by the UK government. There are some of those cuts to working tax credits, of course, that are going to affect, you know, 200,000 families with children across Scotland to the tune of about £3,000 a year on average, that we will not have the ability to do anything about because those powers are staying with Westminster. But around disability payments, for example, we'll have the scope to do things differently. Now, in terms of your point about what budget is transferred to Scotland is a material point. Now, you will probably recall that after the general election, or round about the general election, I think we initially called for this beforehand, we called on the UK government to stop the rollout of personal independence payments, because that rollout from DLE to PIP encapsulates a massive cut in budget. Now, we've called and we still call for that to stop, so that what we get transferred to us is the budget before those cuts are made. And I would hope that's something that the Welfare Reform Committee, I would hope that that's something that all members of this Parliament can agree to. Because if what the budget that's transferred to us comes with that, I think, I'll correct myself if I'm wrong on this, I think it's a £2 billion cut that Scotland would take a share of. If the money that's transferred to us comes with that cut, then clearly there will be more difficult decisions and more difficult issues for this Parliament to grapple with. But make no mistake about it, my objective is to protect people as far as we possibly can from the cuts that are being made to disability and to other benefits.
Yeah, thanks, President Officer. But, you know, it kind of begs the point, First Minister, that if those cuts, unwelcome as they are, do happen, will you take steps to make sure that there are no losers. But the other thing, Presiding Officer, that I wanted to ask was, there's been some concern expressed, or some uncertainty, I suppose, is a better way of putting it, by a lot of voluntary and charitable organisations about how a new benefit system would work. They're not quite clear about whether assessments and then delivery of benefits will be done by a national agency or local agencies. Some are more inclined to not have local decision-making, but there are implications. What thoughts, the second part of this, what thoughts have the Scottish Government given to any new system, whether it's national or local assessments and national or local delivery?
Well, we have some experience, as I assume you'll be well aware of, it, as convener of the Welfare Reform Committee, when we were establishing the Scottish Welfare Fund, around exactly those debates. And what we found there was there was actually a difference of opinion. Some thought that it should be a nationally delivered system, some thought it should be a locally delivered system. What we went for there was a system that was delivered by local authorities within the context of national guidance. Now, you know, no system will work perfectly, and a new system we always have to learn from, but the experience of the Welfare Fund is that that is being delivered well and is benefiting a lot of people. Now, that model won't necessarily be appropriate for the other benefits that we're taking responsibility for, and so these are discussions we'll continue to have, and it may not be a one-size-fits-all approach. You'll be aware, and you will recollect from the programme for government, that I've said we will set out more of our thinking around the new social security powers later this year, and assuming we're re-elected, next May, it would be our intention to bring forward a social security bill within the first year of the next Parliament, in order that we are, with the full input of Parliament, preparing to assume those powers. And those decisions will be a part of that. We've not reached final decisions on all of these issues yet. Some of it will flow from the final shape of the Scotland Bill and the fiscal framework. Some of it will flow from our experience and the input of various different organisations. And I would anticipate that the Welfare Committee will be centrally involved in those deliberations as well.
Thank you, Bruce Crawford, the Convener of the Devolution for the Powers Committee. And Bruce will be followed by Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you, President Officer. First Minister, the Smith Report was very clear on the need to put the legislative consent mechanism on a statutory basis. So it would be useful to hear from the First Minister where discussions have got to with the UK Government in that regard. Also, how important do you believe it is to ensure that the legislative consent provisions in the New Scotland Bill are clear, that the UK Parliament cannot legislate without the Scottish Parliament's consent? And given your strong perspective on where you stand in the human rights, potential repeal of the Human Rights Act, do you believe that the proposed changes to trade union law should also require the consent of the Scottish Parliament?
Thanks, Convener. Let me just... Well, firstly, I'll take the last part of your question first. Yes, I do. I absolutely think that the trade union bill should require a legislative consent motion. The position of the UK government will be it doesn't, because employment law is reserved. But that bill, which I fundamentally oppose, and I think many people in this parliament fundamentally oppose it, will have a significant impact potentially on the relationship of the Scottish government with its own employees and on employment relations generally in Scotland. It will have an impact on the work that's been done, for example, through the Fair Work Convention. So I think, given the impact it would have on devolved responsibilities, I think it is absolutely the case that it should require a legislative consent motion. And that kind of neatly takes me on, actually, to where we are with the discussions around the Smith Commission proposal and the Scotland Bill in terms of putting that convention onto a statutory footing. Firstly, you know, we welcome the agreement to put it onto a statutory footing, but the proposal that's currently in the Scotland Bill, we are concerned, and I am concerned, doesn't go as far as it should do. I don't want to get overly technical here, but there are effectively three elements to the Sewell Convention, as it was known. Firstly, the consent of the Scottish Parliament should be required for bills that contain provisions that apply to Scotland and which are for devolved purposes. Secondly, bills that would alter the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament. And thirdly, bills that would alter the executive competence of the Scottish ministers. Now, when you read the clause in the draft bill where it simply says the UK Parliament will not normally legislate with regard to devolved matters without the consent of the Scottish Parliament. You know, you could read that as saying that that only applies to the first of these three aspects of the convention. And that comes back to, I guess, how this has been done. What the Scotland Bill in its current form seems to be doing is, you know, placing the convention on a statutory into legislation as a convention, as opposed to unpacking the convention and putting all of the specific aspects of it into to law. So we'll continue to argue the case that that has to be set out much more clearly. Or the danger would be, and I put it more strongly than this, the danger would be trying to translate it into law. And the other thing it doesn't do, of course, is put into statute all of the consultation and the sort of mechanisms between the two governments in advance of making these decisions. And if it doesn't do all of that, then the danger is we actually end up in a weaker position than we are with the operation of the convention just now. So we've got to guard against that. And actually, the trade union bill is quite a good example of a bill that, if we get this right in the legislation, it would be beyond doubt that a bill that had such an impact on aspects of how we do our business here in Scotland clearly required the legislative consent of the Parliament.
Thank you.
Thank you, Stuart Stevenson, the convener of Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. And Stuart will be followed by Stuart Maxwell.
First Minister, you will of course be aware that the Standards Committee looked at the process of lobbying Parliament and produced a report to inform the government's own plans to introduce a lobbying bill. In our report, we strictly looked at the behaviours of members of the Scottish Parliament. Is the government minded to look at other categories of activities by other people when the lobbying bill is brought forward in relatively early course?
I hope I'm identifying correctly what it is you're getting at here, but if I'm not, you'll come back at me, I'm sure. But the intention of the government in the lobbying bill, which actually was set out in the public consultation, is for the register to cover the lobbying of all MSPs, including MSPs when they're acting in the role as ministers. That's the intention that we intend to carry forward into the legislation.
That's helpful, First Minister. Obviously, another source of decision-making that's important is civil servants as well. Is the civil service code sufficiently robust to cover what might be required in lobbying terms, or are you looking at that being part of this as well?
I think the civil service code is robust in those senses, but and so, you know, I would not say that that had to be covered here. But we'll listen carefully to the views that Parliament and your own committee in particular choose to put forward as we take this through. I mean, I think we've got to strike a balance here. And, you know, it's not necessarily a balance that will be easy to strike in absolutely the right place. But that's what we've got to try to do between not compromising the reputation this Parliament has for being open and transparent to people from all walks of Scottish life on the one hand, but on the other hand, making sure that there is absolute transparency and propriety around the decision-making process and the people who might seek to influence that decision-making process. So we'll, you know, seek to take all of those things into account and come into a final position. But the issue I refer to in terms of whether ministers as MSPs as ministers should be covered, I'm very clear that that should be the case.
And finally, and perhaps briefly, the committee has perhaps done something that's not been done before in an enhanced pre-legislative activity that's directly been asked to inform a government bill. Does the government have the view that this has been a useful process that we might look at using in future?
Yes, I do. I think it has been useful. I think it's something, I mean, we may come on to when we're talking about one of the other committees about some of the changes that have been made to the legislative process, particularly the role of the Delegated Powers Committee. I think all of those innovations have had their uses, and I think we should continue to look at how we enhance the legislative process so that we, you know, by the time we come to bringing a bill to Parliament, it's not to say that bill won't not require significant changes through the amendment process, but we've actually taken account of as many views as possible in the pre-legislative phase so that the bill is in as good a shape as it can be.
Stuart Maxwell, the Convener of the Education and Culture Committee, and Stuart will be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, during your programme for government announcement, you made very clear that the Scottish Government's one of its top priorities is closing the attainment gap. And as part of that work, you also announced that your intention to introduce a national improvement framework, which would establish a new nationalised standard assessment regime for primary 1, 4, 7 and S3. Can I just clarify, because the government has said that that will not be the sole measurement used for children in school. What other measurements do you intend to be used?
Well, the other measurements that would be used are broadly the ones that would be used by a teacher now in assessing the performance and the progress of a young person. So, you know, that will be ongoing classwork. It will be written work that children do in their, you know, classroom jotters. It will be presentations, homework, teacher observation. So all of that will still be very important in terms of a teacher forming a judgment, but it will be added to by consistent assessments, because in 30 out of 32 local authorities just now, those sources of information are already added to by assessment, but not all local authorities use the same assessment. So what we're seeking to do here is standardise the assessment, because we're also going to do assessments that are bespoke, if you like, to Curriculum for Excellence, as opposed to, you know, bought in from external sources. It will be much more aligned to the objectives of Curriculum for Excellence. So all of that information taken together will enable the teacher to form the judgment about whether a child is meeting the required level at Curriculum for Excellence. And in a sense, that is what distinguishes the assessments that we are proposing to introduce from what people would describe as the national testing of old. The concerns that many teachers have about testing, which I would share, are when it becomes high stakes, be-all and end-all, pass-fail, and that is the only measure of a child's progress. That's not what we are envisaging here with assessments. It will be another source of information to help inform in an objective and consistent way the judgment that a teacher will arrive at.
Thank you very much for that. I'm glad you raised that point, because my second question, Presiding Officer, is on that very fact. There's been concerns raised on two points in particular. One is, how do you stop effectively those assessments becoming league tables? And, you know, how do the government intend to do that? Because clearly one of the suggestions would be they don't publish the raw data, for example. So I think there has been some discussion, certainly in education circles, about that. And I wondered if you could give us your view as how that's how you prevent that from happening, given your previous answer. And secondly, one of the other concerns that's been raised is how you allow the National Improvement Framework to be assessed itself and its success. Will effectively schools and education authorities be able to use the data that's been produced from the previous testing regimes or assessment regimes and compare that with the data that will be produced by the National Improvement Framework? In other words, will it be a case where we lose the data from the last lot of assessments, or will there be a way of comparing across the previous assessments with the new standardised assessments?
There will, I'll take both parts of those questions in reverse order. There will be some limited comparison possible using the evidence that is already available in local authorities from existing assessments, existing teacher judgment, and also the information that has been gathered through the SSLN, the Scottish Survey of Literacy and Numeracy. But because we are designing new assessments, which, you know, as I've said in the programme for government, will be piloted in the challenge authorities next year and rolled out nationally from 2017, there won't be a direct comparison available, but what that will enable over time is those comparisons to be made. And in time, although this will be in time, the new assessments will replace the SSLN surveys. In terms of the publication, this is an issue where we will continue to consult carefully before reaching final decisions on the nature and form of data publication, because I have no interest in producing information that just becomes crude league tables that don't actually tell parents or teachers or politicians or anybody anything meaningful about the performance of schools. So we have to make sure that any information we providers in the right context and is able to be used in a meaningful way. We actually should take some heart from the fact that we do that already in terms of the information that is published through, you know, parent zone, for example, in the upper parts of secondary school, where, yes, there will be people in the media will seek to turn that into league tables, but to the best of my knowledge, most teachers and parents are quite comfortable with the context in which that is published. So we're not yet at a conclusion in terms of exactly how this will happen, but we will do it in a way that guards against, as far as we can, the putting together and publishing of league tables that tell us nothing about school performance.
Just on behalf of teachers, and are we sure? Question and answer, which is, will it generate more work for teachers?
Briefly, First Minister.
No, because 30 of the 32 local authorities already do these assessments. This is about streamlining. There are actually some local authorities that Education in Scotland might think over-assess just now. So this is about streamlining and making sure the assessments are aligned with curriculum for excellence.
Murdo Fraser, the convener of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee, and Murdo will be followed by Jim Eady.
Thank you. The Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee is conducting an inquiry into work, wages and wellbeing. So my questions follow on from Duncan McNeill's first question around the Fair Work Convention and the Business Pledge. I think the committee would take the view that the Business Pledge is a very, very worthwhile, its objectives are sound. I think so far 100 businesses have signed up to it. That's out of 200,000 businesses in Scotland. So the take-up has been quite minimal thus far. One of the issues we try to explore in evidence is the question of conditionality. We took evidence from the government's various agencies, Scottish Enterprise, Skills Development Scotland, and they've told us that they don't treat businesses who've signed the pledge any different to those who haven't, which perhaps explains why the take-up rate has not been so significant. But I'm wondering, did the Scottish Government consider this question of conditionality, and if it decided not to go down that route, what was the reason for that?
This is an important question, and it's an important area of deliberation, because we did, you know, consider the issue of conditionality when we were putting the business pledge together. On the uptake, I'm actually quite optimistic about the uptake. I think these things often take time to percolate through the business community, but I've been quite encouraged actually by the degree of interest and not just the number, but the types of businesses signing up so far, and I would predict that we'll see a lot more of that in the months to come. We consider carefully the issue of conditionality, and what I'd say firstly is, you know, I'm not close-minded. We'll monitor very carefully how the business pledge works and the impact it has on business practice. But the reason we decided not to go down the road of conditionality, I suppose, gets to the whole philosophy of what we're trying to do through the Fair Work Agenda. What we're trying to say to businesses, and I think many businesses absolutely embrace this, is that fair work, whether that's the living wage or good practices, all the things covered by the business pledge, shouldn't be something that businesses are seen as kind of burdens on them that they have to be forced to do. They are things that, by doing, businesses make themselves more productive, more competitive, and more successful. So it's that kind of virtuous approach that we're seeking to take. Now, I think, and you know, there were people who would have argued for an approach of conditionality. I took the view that if we're trying to get businesses to see this as something that is actually good for them to do, that would have been the wrong way to start on this. But, you know, we'll continue to consider these things as the business pledge continues to develop.
OK. Thank you. That's a very helpful response. Can I just follow up on one aspect of the business pledge, which is that the companies who sign up undertake not to use exploitative zero-hours contracts. Now, when Scottish Enterprise came to the committee, I think it was 2 weeks ago, I asked them if they could tell us what an exploitative zero-hours contract was, and they couldn't give me a definition. So we're asking businesses to sign up to something that is not defined. So can you tell me what in your view, is an exploitative zero-hours contract?
That term comes from a recognition that there will be some businesses in some sectors where the use of zero-hours contracts is necessary given the nature of the business, but also there will be sectors where employees are happy to sign up on that basis. But I think that is is the minority, not the majority. So exploitative, I'm happy to write to your committee with the kind of full explanation of what I'm about to see here. But in summary, it's where employees are not, would prefer to be on contracts that weren't 0 hours, where the use is haphazard, where people have genuinely no full understanding, where it's not required in terms of the nature of the business, where, and we've had bad practices like this in the past, where employees who are on 0 hours contracts are not allowed to work for other companies while they're signed up to a 0 hours contract, so they're effectively trapped with that situation. So these are the kind of aspects of exploitative. But I'm happy to write in more detail about...
You're now asking people to sign up to this now, without it being clear what that means.
In my experience, and I'm absolutely sure that you'd be able to give me exceptions to this, in my experience, companies do have a fairly good idea of what crosses the line between an appropriate use of a zero-hours contract and an exploitative use of a zero-hours contract. But if that's an area where further discussion and dialogue with your committee would help, because I'm, it's in our interest for companies to be clear about what we're asking them to sign up to. So if there's work that it would be helpful to do through your committee, I'd be happy to do that.
Okay. Committee, the Convener of Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee, and Jim will be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and good afternoon, First Minister. You've announced the Scottish Government's intention to introduce a private tenancies bill, which I believe will be published shortly, the purpose of which will be, as I understand it, to provide security of tenure, predictability on rent increases and a stable tenancy for tenants in the private rented sector. Can I ask you specifically about protection of tenants against excessive rent increases, including the ability to introduce local rent controls for rent pressure areas? In terms of that specific proposal, can you explain how you would envisage it working in practice, and how will you determine what a rent pressure area will be, and who will take that decision?
Okay, what we've announced, and the bill will be introduced shortly, and we'll go through the full scrutiny process, but what we are proposing are rent controls, or a rent control framework that is proportionate and measured, so that it can mitigate the detrimental effect of excessively rising rents in particular areas. Now, we know from our own statistics that rents in many parts of Scotland are not rising excessively right now, but there are some areas. I would particularly point to Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire here in the Lothians, where rents have been increasing significantly in real terms. So what we are envisaging in the bill is something that is not a blanket one-size-fits-all approach, but an arrangement that gives local authorities the means to apply to ministers for the ability to cap rents in rent pressure zones. That would be for potentially a time-limited period, and the objective of it would be to allow the local authority to ameliorate the effects of excessively high rent rises and protect tenants and the broader housing system from rent rises that are excessively rising. In terms of how we'll reach those decisions, I mean, there'll be an application process for local authorities set out in the bill, and we would use, I've already cited the statistics that we already publish that would provide the evidence of how rents were performing in particular local areas. So what this is intended to do is provide protection for tenants where it's needed, but to make sure we continue to have a system that is proportionate.
Okay, thank you. I think you've set out a clear direction of travel in terms of that specific issue. Can I ask you about another issue? I understand that during the Scottish Government's consultation process, landlords and letting agents expressed concerns about the proposed ending of the no-fault ground for repossessing a property. Can you give us an early indication of how the bill intends to address those concerns?
Again, this is all about proportionality and balance. You know, the private rented sector is becoming increasingly important in Scotland, and it's changing. So, you know, it's now home to somewhere in the region of 700,000 tenants across Scotland. More families are becoming dependent on the private rented sector. So we need to make sure that the regulations that govern that sector are fit for purpose and reflect the nature of it just now. We thought very carefully about the no-fault ground for repossession of tenancies. As you say, we consulted, and it was the case that many landlords expressed concern about that. We think we're striking the right balance. By taking away the no-fault ground, we give added protection for tenants against the knowledge that their property, what is actually their home, can be taken away simply because the tenancy agreement reaches its end date. But what we have ensured on the other side is there will be a range of different grounds where landlords can regain possession of their property. And they will cover, for example, areas where they want to sell it or they want to use it for the purposes of their own family. So we think we're striking the right balance there, and you know, we very much look forward to the input of your committee when it goes through the stage one process.
Okay, thank you.
Vina Justice Committee, and Christine will be followed by Paul Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, probably by reprise of last time, the Justice Committee in this session has dealt with 17 bills, 13 of them government bills, and we usually do, and we have another one on the way, and we usually have at least two, this time it's three currently before us. Criminal justice, a substantial bill at stage two, community justice coming to stage one, and FAIs moving into stage two. If I look at the criminal justice bill, there's 275 amendments have been lodged at stage two. Of these, 160 are government amendments. Now, some are consequentials, but there are quite substantial amendments in there, particularly relating to stop and search and custody. Can I therefore ask, on behalf of the committee, that we are provided with explanatory notes on substantial amendments in early course? As you know, it's very important what's done at stage two of a bill. Quite often at stage three, most of the parliament haven't got much idea what's been going on, but stage two, the committee certainly has. And secondly, and this is perhaps not going to be more controversial, I think, in that, can your government, or indeed I hope subsequent governments, consider a cap on bills in the parliament? To be considering all these bills, to be a unicameral parliament, it is extremely difficult for the committee and indeed the parliament at large, perhaps get it right.
Okay, thanks. Let me take those two things in turn. In terms of this issue of explanatory notes for stage two amendments, I'm sympathetic to the argument behind that. I know the Standards Committee looked at that previously and decided not to recommend that as a standard part of the process. But it has been the case that government has been prepared to share its purpose and effect notes with committee members on an informal basis. Now, my understanding is that has been done in relation to the Criminal Justice Bill for members, and you know, I understand that the committee has found that to be helpful, so I'm certainly happy to give a commitment that we'll carry on with that practice for future bills if conveners and committees think that would be helpful. So I have no difficulty in agreeing with you on that, which takes me on to the second part where I might not be as in much in agreement with you. I'm not in favour of a cap on bills. It should be for a parliament to legislate as it is deemed necessary. Now, you know, in my experience so far in government and on the other side in opposition, I was probably somebody who said this about government often enough. Governments will get criticised either for legislating too little, legislating too much, bringing forward the wrong kinds of legislation. That's just in the nature of it. So I think governments have to have the flexibility to bring forward legislation in the areas and in the quantity that it thinks appropriate from year to year. But, and this is where I'm perhaps moving back into agreement with you, it's also incumbent on the government to make sure that that workload is managed with an understanding of the pressures on committees. Now, the Minister for Parliamentary Business, believe me, does a very stern job with me and with my ministers to make sure that we are understanding of the pressures in committees, and there will always be a willingness on the part of government, in fact a duty on the part of government, to work with committees and committee conveners to manage that. But it's in the nature of things that in some parliamentary sessions one committee will have what will appear like a disproportionate workload, in other sessions it will be other committees that do that, and that's, I think, to some extent in the nature of the beast that we're dealing with.
Well, just to get back to, because you know, one time in the Justice 1 and Justice 2, it got really out of hand, but I think it's getting out of hand again. very much welcome the FAI bill and domestic abuse that's coming and human trafficking. These are excellent. But the balance has shifted for the Justice Committee. It is a manager of the Select and Standing Committee. We're trying to do an inquiry into surveillance of journalists and MSPs. We would like to look, we can't do human rights. It's had to be passed the European Committee. We've had to set up a subcommittee on policing, which denies the whole committee the opportunity to scrutinise Police Scotland. There's absolutely no space for post-legislative scrutiny. Now, I, with respect, and I mean that genuinely, I'm not using that in the lawyer's way, when you don't respect people at all, is that I feel that the balance has shifted and that governments, not just your government, First Minister, but governments shouldn't just be measured on the quantity of the legislation, but the quality. And that's my concern, that we're not able to do that and do inquiries as we used to be able to do. So I just leave it at that.
Before you answer, First Minister, can I just say that I hope that the submission that Christine Graham is making now will be similar to a submission she will make to the Standards Committee, who are looking at the moment about committee reform. First Minister.
I was just going to start by saying, Christine, I've known and loved you long enough to know exactly what you mean when you say with respect. there was no need to clarify it for me there. Look, I'm not unsympathetic to the case you're making. I think you're making a compelling case. I was going to make the same point the presiding officer has just made about the work the Standards Committee is doing. We have already, of course, seen changes, and I'm aware we've not come on to Nigel Dawn's committee yet, but in terms of what now happens with uncontroversial Law Commission proposed legislation, what we might be looking at in the future in terms of consolidation bills, all of that intended to take the pressure off subject committees to some extent. But I appreciate this. I guess the difficulty you get into, though, is when it comes to, and you read out some of the bills that your committee is dealing with, when it comes to saying, well, which of these ones don't we need to do? And that's when it becomes much more of a hard-edged discussion. So we will continue as government to make sure we work with committees to recognise, because your point's about both quality of legislation, but also the space for committees to do non-legislative work, I think is very important. So I can't promise you a magic solution to this, because I don't think a cap on bills would be appropriate, but I can promise you that we'll continue to listen and to work very closely with committees to try to manage the pressures that you're identifying.
Paul Martin, Convener of the Public Audit Committee, and to be followed by Nigel Dawn.
First Minister, you will be aware of the various reports that the committee is considering in connection with the governance of the severance arrangements in connection with the college mergers. You advised the Chamber recently in an exchange at First Minister's question time that there would be in place stronger national controls to ensure that there would be no reoccurrence, or hopefully make it more difficult for a reoccurrence of the severance arrangements that were agreed by the colleges. Could you advise me what those specific controls are?
Well, I think what I said in the chamber, well, I said a couple of things in the chamber that I was not at all happy with the severance arrangements that, you know, were being discussed around Coatbridge College. What I pointed to, though, was not changes that were going to be made, but changes that have already been made in terms of, for example, the changes that took effect in April last year when colleges were reclassified by the Office of National Statistics, and as a result of that, stronger financial controls came into effect. So that's one of the key changes that has been made that would change the rules and regulations in place were a college to be looking to do what Coatbridge College did previously. We will also look, and you know, I've said this openly, whether there are other things that we could put in place, but I think the most important change is the one that I've already spoken about, and that has already happened.
So, okay. I mean, can I take you back, though, to the Audit Scotland's report, and specifically they refer to an exchange with the Scottish Funding Council in October 2013, where the Scottish Funding Council asked requested that there's clarity in whether there was best value for money in respect to the agreements that were reached. Now, can I just ask you that, given what you've advised us and the current state of play today, could there be a reoccurrence of a situation where there could be an exchange with the Scottish Funding Council requesting that information, and the college could still go ahead with the severance arrangements?
Well, the change, I'll come on and Well, maybe start with that. There's no doubt that the guidance that was given by the SFC wasn't acted upon with Coatbridge College, and there were concerns about the fact it wasn't even brought to the attention of some of the people, the Remuneration Committee, for example. So these are serious issues. I know your committee intends, well, I believe your committee intends to look further into this, and I think that is entirely appropriate. But The changes that took place in April 2014 as a result of the ONS reclassification is that colleges must now seek prior approval from SFC of both severance and settlement arrangements, and the college reforms that have been undertaken also now give ministers explicit powers to intervene in such circumstances. So previously it was a case of the SFC stating a view that wasn't acted on. The change now is that colleges must seek the approval of the SFC for severance and settlement arrangements. So that is a substantive difference, which I certainly hope would mean that what we saw at Coatbridge and the particular circumstances of that would not happen again.
So can I just ask finally then, is it your understanding that the SFC couldn't intervene on this occasion, on the previous occasion, that they were legally
we're looking,
not in a position to do that?
We're looking carefully, and again, this is something I'd be happy to explore with your committee. We're looking with a critical eye at whether there is any more the SFC could have done back then, but you know, my understanding is there were limitations back then that are now not the same because of the changes to the classification and what grew from that. So I don't want to sit here and give a definitive nothing further could be done, because you know, these situations, the one that we're looking at in particular right now, are not acceptable. They're not acceptable at any time, but when public money is under as much pressure as it's under just now, you know, they're just flatly unacceptable, and we need to make sure that we've got the right arrangements in place to protect against that.
Nigel Dawn, the convener of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, and followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, you've already referred to the change in the standing orders, which has enabled my committee to take on some legislation. We enjoyed the legal writings bill. I think we're currently enjoying an expiration to the law of succession, and I think we're probably fairly saying that we're expecting to deal with bankruptcy and a consolidation bill. I'm wondering whether you can give me your thoughts, First Minister, on how we might in the future take forward both law of form and also the maintenance of the statute book.
I think that the changes that have been made actually open the way to that. I visited the Law Commission just a few weeks ago to help them celebrate their 50th anniversary, and certainly they were very complimentary about how the changes have enabled and will enable in future perhaps a more effective and efficient way of keeping the statute book up to date and fit for purpose. The government's view of how the changes worked with the legal writings bill is very positive. I know the Standards Committee will be looking at this, and our feedback from the experience so far into that committee will be entirely positive. The succession bill is obviously the second bill to go through these new procedures, and you've already referred, as I have, to different procedures around consolidation. So I think it goes back to the points Christine Graham was making. When a committee like the Justice Committee is so under pressure with new legislation, the scope for doing consolidation or, you know, for tidying up the law becomes much less. With the change that puts that onus on your committee, I think we open the door to doing much more of that, and I think that's in the interests of good maintenance of the statute book.
Okay. Kevin Stewart, the convener of the Local Government and Regeneration Committee, followed by Margaret McCullough.
Thank you. The programme for government says that the Scottish Government will review the operation of the planning system with a view to introducing changes that deliver a quicker, more accessible and efficient system, with a particular focus on increasing the delivery of housing developments. Can I ask you, First Minister, how can we ensure that people and communities across Scotland have confidence in the planning system?
Well, part of the reason for undertaking this, what we describe as a root and branch review, is to make sure that that is the case, that the planning system, as far as any planning system can ever do this, is striking the right balance between economic and infrastructure development, and making sure that the views and the tensions that sometimes come out of the views that communities have are properly taken account of. So the review, as you will know, because your committee's looking carefully at this, will focus on six key strategic priorities: development planning, housing delivery, planning for infrastructure, further improvement to development management, leadership, resourcing and skills, and lastly, community engagement. And that community engagement part is a very important aspect of it.
Sometimes communities don't feel particularly engaged, and one example in my own patch is the Marshall Square development. How can we ensure that other council aims and policies don't colour local authority planning decisions?
Well, I guess, I mean, the two things are completely different, but in some ways, this takes me back to the discussion I had with Duncan McNeill about the Scottish Medicines Consortium. You can have in place the best system that is possible to have in place. It will not stop decisions being taken that some people disagree with, or some people, for very, very good and understandable reasons, feel very strongly is the wrong decision. So it doesn't matter what we do with the planning system, we will not avoid some communities on some decisions being seriously aggrieved at outcomes. But that makes it all the more important that the system is transparent, that there is an understanding of it, that there are meaningful ways in which community voices can be heard, and that councils, planning authorities, and if that's the case of ministers taking decisions, as we sometimes do in these things, that there is an accountability and an openness in terms of explaining why decisions have been reached. So again, there's no magic kind of wand that can be waved to make these things easy and controversy-free, but there are things that we can do to improve the system so that it better meets these various objectives.
One of the things which could maybe improve the situation is better communication between planning authorities and communities. Is that going to be looked at as part of the root and branch review?
Obviously, I don't want to start doing the job of the panel that's been appointed to do this, but community engagement, in my view, would encompass the issue of communication. And you know, I've got plenty of constituency experience, as every member around this table will have, of planning decisions that are incredibly controversial. Now, in my experience, and it doesn't always take away the controversy in these decisions, but the more engagement and communication there can be as early as possible in the process, the better it is, and the more chance there is of getting a way through issues which are very contentious for communities. So I think any meaningful look at community engagement will look at that important issue of communication as well.
Thank you.
Pip McCulloch, the convener of the Equal Opportunities Committee, to be followed by Rob Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Like the Finance Committee, First Minister, the Equal Opportunities Committee has highlighted the importance of early intervention and reducing social risks as a way of preventing social problems and inequalities. In our inquiry on age and isolation, we heard about the public health risks of loneliness. It could be as bad for your health as smoking. We even heard about a woman living alone, so isolated that she was living without power. I can see from the programme for government that you understand we have to move away from preventable spending to preventative spending. And the Christie Commission estimated that 40% of public spending is accounted for by interventions that could have been prevented. Where would you put that figure now?
I'm happy to provide that figure. I don't have what that figure would be now to hand, but I'll write to you and to your committee with what our estimate of that would be. In terms of the guts of your question and the substance of your question, you know, I think you know from the focus of our work that we absolutely very strongly agree that the more we can prevent problems occurring, then, you know, the more effectively and efficiently public money will be used and the better people's quality of life will be. I'd really welcome the work that your committee is doing around age and loneliness, because while it's not the case that older people are the only group where this prevention agenda is important, there's no doubt that in terms of preventing ill health, preventing hospital admissions, dealing with some of the pressures that we see occurring in our acute health service, caring for older people, better in their own homes and own communities is a key part of that. And that goes beyond just aids and adaptations or digital health technology. It does come down to people's sense of community and not having people isolated in their own communities. So, you know, you'll be aware, for example, of the Silver Line 24/7 helpline and the work we're doing on digital participation, because actually the internet is not the whole answer to this, but it is one way in which we help to keep older people connected and stop them being isolated. So it's a massive, massive area of work, but one, you know, for the best of reasons, but particularly given tight public finances, we absolutely have to keep focused on.
Okay. And very briefly, you may not have the answers for this, but I'll ask anyway. Do you think there has been a decisive shift towards preventative spending?
Yes, I do. And, you know, we can evidence, you know, I can look at our early years intervention fund, our change fund, which was established when I was health secretary, looking now at what we're doing around the integration of health and social care, which, you know, is not a single big bang exercise, but it is about moving health spend from the acute sector into communities, into preventative spend. So yes, we have seen that shift start to happen. Are we at the end of that journey? Absolutely not. There's still a considerable way to go.
Thank you.
Rob Gibson, the convener of Rural Affairs, Climate Change and the Environment Committee, and Rob will be followed by Michael McMahon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, land ownership patterns have a profound impact on the best uses of our most basic natural resource. What makes the approach of this session's Land Reform Bill different to previous interventions in land ownership and use by previous Scottish parliaments?
But the Land Reform Bill that's currently before Parliament is, in one sense, part of a journey of land reform. I think there was too big a gap from the previous one to this one, but it's part of a journey. There's many aspects of the detail of that bill that obviously make it different from previous legislative initiatives. But I guess if I was to sum up what makes it different, it's how we're seeking to develop a framework for how we continue to reform land use and access and ownership, you know, around the land register, the land rights and responsibilities statement, for example. So, you know, it's that framework that means this bill is not, you know, necessarily the end of the road, but paves the way to making sure that we keep land use and ownership under constant review.
Indeed, thank you for that. Stakeholders have strongly highlighted the need for transparency of land ownership. Can Scotland's sub-state government find watertight ways to identify the beneficial owners of Scottish land to encourage responsible land ownership and to ensure that these holdings can be suitably taxed?
I think in the bill, yes, we are seeking to do that, although we'll you know, consider carefully any points that are made in the progress of this about how we can strengthen it. I mean, we've looked very carefully, as you would have expected us to do, given that transparency of ownership and greater information about who owns and controls land was one of the key issues that was identified by the Land Reform Review Group. Basically, as you'll be aware of from the detail of the bill, Section 35 is the key section that deals with this, and that section allows regulations to be made that will then provide people who are affected by land to request information about individuals with control of that land. Section 36 also allows regulations to be made that provide the keeper of the registers of Scotland to request additional information about the category of the proprietor and individuals who have a controlling interest, because the issue of who lies behind ownership is one of the key ones. Now, obviously, the review group made recommendations around EU incorporated legal entities. Obviously, we've looked carefully at that. One of the complications with that is that the rules around corporate transparency aren't consistent across different European countries. So we could find that, notwithstanding what we tried to do in that act, you would still have complex structures and certain countries that would obscure ownership. So we're trying to bring as much transparency to this as possible in as meaningful a way as possible, and we look forward to continued engagement on it.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Finally, Michael McMahon, the convener of the Public Petitions Committee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, you'll be aware that, like no other committee in the Parliament, our agenda is set by the public. So we've looked at issues that have come up to try and identify areas where there might have been some pressing concerns raised, maybe disproportionately to others. And that area that we discovered was in transport. In your programme for government, you discussed taking forward investment in a variety of transport services under the heading of creating a strong, sustainable economy. But given the wide array of petitions that have come to us on transport from individuals, from organisations, from communities, do you believe that in terms of transport policy, that the government is getting it right, given that there is a disproportionate amount of petitioning of the Parliament in relation to transport issues?
I know we are making substantial investment in transport, in roads, in the rail network, in improving air routes and in the whole gamut of, and also cycling and greener, cleaner modes of transport. So we're making huge investment in all of that. I think our record speaks for itself in terms of some of the significant projects and improvements we've made or are making, from, you know, the new Queen's Ferry crossing to the Border Railway that I had the privilege of opening just a few weeks ago. We've started work, as you know, on dualling the A9. So across all of that, I think the government's got a very, very strong record of delivery. You know, that's not, though, and this is where, you know, if I was just to sit here and say we're getting it right and there's no more we could do, I'd be, you know, horrendously complacent, and I'm not, that's not my way of looking at things. There will be communities all over Scotland who have particular transport issues that they want to see action on, or they want to see more urgent action on, and we've got to balance all of that in coming up with an affordable and deliverable programme of investment. Now, you know, I was looking at some of the petitions you've been dealing with, you know, on the junction at Lawrencekirk, for example, the A83, rest and be thankful, the school bus safety. These are all examples of where particular communities have particular transport challenges, and we've got to work with those communities to assess the priority and then to factor that into an overall strategic approach to the ongoing continuous improvement of our transport network.
Yeah. Well, thanks very much for that. I do agree with you that sometimes the creation of transport projects actually brings some of the petitions about themselves when people are either not happy with them or they don't think they're achieving the aims intended for them. But one community that there may have been an unintended consequence that's impacted on them, you mentioned the promotion of cycling. And there have been petitions that have brought to our attention in relation to the adverse impact on the ScotRail franchise, because in encouraging people to access cycling and go onto the trains in order to do that, that the disabled community feel that they are being pushed off. So accessibility of transportation is actually a problem for the community that are disabled. And I just wonder if you have any comments on how we can address those issues.
I'd be happy to look in more detail at those specific petitions, because I, you know, feel very, very strongly that enabling people to access trains with bikes and enabling people with disabilities to access trains are not either or. They are not mutually exclusive. They are both, in their own way and for their own reasons, very, very important. So, yes, I'd be concerned if one or other was hindering access to one or other. So I'm happy. I haven't looked in detail at those particular petitions, but I'm happy to do so and see if there's anything. I'll also raise it with Derek Mackay, the Transport Minister, and ask him to have a look at this particular issue as well.
Thank you very much. Can I thank all of the conveners for keeping the time? We do have a wee bit of time in hand, so before the First Minister thinks she can escape, can I just remind some people that they do have questions at 2 o'clock, so I know that some members will have to go. But what I thought was maybe about 5-6 minutes, if anybody wants a follow-up to the First Minister on something they've asked, I'm quite happy to allow them to do so. Bruce Crawford.
Well, I didn't ask a supplementary, so this is my chance now. Obviously, the report stage of the Scotland Bill will soon be reached
in the House of Commons. You'll be aware, First Minister, that my committee has, to say the least, reservations about whether or not the bill as it's currently shaped meets the recommendations of Smith. I just wondered what progress is being made with the UK government in discussing what amendments are likely to come forward. Are we likely to see any substantial progress? I know we've seen one in one area around permanency, and there are some doubts about this, how effective it will be, but that's all we've seen to date. And I just wonder what discussions you've had, what progress has been made?
Well, you know, those discussions are ongoing. John Swinney has met the Secretary of State relatively recently, but the short answer is we don't yet know what further amendments the Secretary of State intends to bring forward at report stage, with the exception of the one amendment on permanency, which we have a number of technical doubts about, but I won't go into them at the moment. So, you know, I think it's now incumbent on the Secretary of State to bring forward the amendments that he says he wants to bring forward. I hope to see substantial amendments that meet the issues that your committee identified, issues that the government has been pushing since the bill was published. So I would very much hope that we will see amendments on the Sewell Convention that I spoke about earlier on, further amendments on social security, on employment services, on the Crown Estate. I hope we see the removal of all the vetoes that currently litter the bill in terms of giving the UK government the power in certain circumstances to veto decisions of the Scottish Government. But we await further information on what those might be. So hopefully we'll see them sooner rather than later.
There is always two, First Minister.
I was going to push my luck with another one.
Thanks. First Minister, you know, last year at this time, or another time? The last time we were here, anyway, we were talking about some of the stuff that Margaret McCulloch was talking about whether we have sufficiently funded that vision for transformation to move to a more preventive system and take account of the demographic challenges that we do have and deliver our healthcare closer at home, closer to home. You know, we had that discussion, and you were saying that at that time you were absolutely committed to the 2020 vision. Are you still confident you'll meet the 2020 vision target of 2020, and you believe that it's sufficiently funded to reach that target and deliver by that time?
I'm confident 2020 will come around in 2020.
Well, but
yes.
Will you deliver on by 2020?
Yeah, I mean, we've set out the 2020 vision. Shona Robinson, as you know, is now consulting through the national conversation on how we extend that vision to make sure we've got a health service that is adapting to the changing demographics, adapting to, you know, new discoveries, to the changing use of technology. So in a sense, with the health service, given the nature of it, that will be an ongoing exercise. The question about, are we funding it sufficiently? Are we giving it the priority within the finite resources we've got? Yes, I believe we are. You can always argue any issue should have more money, and if you had more money, you would give it more money. But are we giving the health service? We've protected the resource budget of the health service, and within that, you know, I talked in the programme for government about the primary care transformation work that we're doing and the test sites that we'll develop over the next year. So yes, I believe we're giving it the priority it deserves within the resources that we have as a government.
Will we deliver by 2020?
Yes, we will deliver where we want to be, but you know, when we get to 2020, the health service is always changing, so we'll need to look at where we want it to be in 2030. The point I'm making is, and you know this, everybody knows this, the health service, by the nature of it, never gets to a point where it can stand still. So the work to support the 2020 vision that's been done just now around the clinical strategy, for example, that, yes, has to look at where we'll be in 2020, but it also has to move forward to where we'll be 10 years, 20 years, 30 years from that, because the world doesn't stand still, and as long as the world doesn't stand still, the National Health Service will never stand still.
Can I thank all of the conveners? First Minister, can I thank you once again for coming and putting yourself forward through it. Thank you for putting yourself forward to do this. This is likely to be the final session with the conveners and the First Minister before the end of the session. It's the last time I'm likely to be in the chair for this, but I do hope that in the future the conveners group and the First Minister can also come to an arrangement to have a meeting such as these. So thank you once again for giving up your time. Thank you for
coming to this conveners group meeting. Can I thank all the conveners? Can I thank you particularly young people from St Ninian's School? I hope you found that interesting. Thanks a lot, everybody.